As the presiding officer said, we now move to this debate, and I now call on Maureen Watt to speak to and move the motion. 14 minutes, please, as soon as you're ready. Ms. Watt.
Thank you very much, presiding officer, and I'm delighted to open the stage one debate on the principles of the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine and Care Scotland Bill. I would like to thank the Health and Sport Committee for their consideration and stage one report. I'd also like to thank the Finance Committee and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their consideration of the bill. I'm pleased that evidence was taken from such a wide range of organisations and individuals. I welcome the opportunity to discuss the principles of the bill and the positive contribution it will make to both public health and the delivery of health and social care services in Scotland. The Health and Sport Committee made a number of detailed recommendations in their Stage 1 report. I responded to these yesterday, but I will address some of the more significant points here today. Our bill defines electronic cigarettes as nicotine vapour products, or NVPs. The bill builds on the requirements of the EU Tobacco Products Directive, which must apply across the United Kingdom by the 20th of May 2016. The directive sets standards for the composition, labelling and marketing of devices and e-liquids. On the basis of current evidence, NVPs are generally considered to be a less harmful alternative to tobacco. However, there is also consensus that the inhalation of these products is not risk-free, particularly for young people and those with some medical conditions. Whilst emerging evidence suggests that NVPs could help smokers to quit tobacco, there is a lack of evidence about the short and long-term effects of vaping. In the absence of long-term evidence, the committee heard a range of concerns about whether these products might normalise smoking behaviours and act as a gateway to nicotine addiction and/or smoking. Debates around these concerns will continue, but we can all agree that there are certainly no benefits to be had from children playing at smoking. The revised EU Tobacco Products Directive will place restrictions on cross-border advertising of e-cigarettes, for example, TV and radio advertising. Our bill builds on this by taking powers to prohibit domestic advertising, such as billboards, posters and leaflets. However, I do not intend to buy certain point-of-sale advertising of NVPs in Scotland. It is important that current smokers are able to access information, ask questions and receive consultation about which products might be right for them. The committee asked the Scottish Government to consider whether the NHS should issue national guidance about the potential risks and benefits of using an NVP to quit smoking. The Scottish Government is working with NHS boards to establish a consistent approach to providing advice and support to individuals who want to stop smoking using NVPs. The bill will introduce an age verification policy for the sale of NVPs and tobacco. It will also ban unauthorised sales by a person under the age of 18. These measures strengthen the age restrictions associated with sale of tobacco products and NVPs. Likewise, banning the sale of NVPs from vending machines reflects the fact that self-service vending machines cannot satisfactorily include a process for the vendor to verify age. Any person who intends to sell NVPs will be required to register on a retail register. This requirement has been in place for tobacco products since 2011. It has proved a useful tool for trading standards officers in both supporting retailers and enforcing tobacco sales legislation. The approach taken in the bill provides consistency across tobacco and NVPs without placing undue burdens on retailers. The committee highlighted concerns that extending the tobacco register to NVPs could mislead people to think that they have the same level of harm. That is not my intention. In implementing the legislation, the Scottish Government will explore opportunities to provide a clear separation between the products on the website where the register is publicly available. The bill also proposes an offence of smoking and of knowingly permitting smoking in the perimeter around buildings on NHS hospital grounds. This is not about stigmatising smokers, Preventing ill health is a major challenge for our health services now and in the future. Tobacco remains the biggest cause of preventable disease and death in Scotland. The committee heard evidence that our NHS must show leadership in supporting and promoting healthy behaviours, particularly around tackling smoking. The bill provides an enforcement tool to support existing smoke-free hospital ground policies. As an alternative, the committee suggested that the Scottish Government considers allowing NHS boards to set different perimeters within their own grounds. However, it is important to recognise that boards have been encouraged to set their own smoke-free grounds policies since the introduction of smoke-free legislation nearly a decade ago. In developing our current tobacco control strategy, there was a clear ask of government to support a consistent approach across boards. In introducing legislation to support smoke-free policies, I believe that consistency is essential. It is important that we can communicate a simple and clear message about the requirements of the law. Setting perimeters with a different distance at each NHS hospital site could lead to confusion about what constitutes an offence. The Scottish Government will, however, consult with health boards in developing the details of the smoke-free perimeter.
Okay, Minister.
I wonder if the Minister could give us an indication if any patients who are smokers have signed themselves out of hospital early because they've been unable to smoke, and whether that causes further problems down the line for those patients and for the NHS.
Minister?
I can tell the member that I'm not aware of that happening. If he has got evidence of that happening, I'm happy to look into it. But obviously, I would have hoped that patients would discuss their smoking with their doctors and consultants, perhaps even before they are due to have an operation. And obviously, help is given to patients who are coming into hospital to quit as soon as they know what the situation is within hospital grounds. Presiding officer, can I move to the duty of candour? The provision of health and social care services is closely associated with risk, and unintended or unexpected events resulting in harm sometimes happen. This doesn't mean that we should not be honest and open when harm occurs and to seek to learn and improve from such incidents. Being candid promotes a learning culture, accountability for safer systems, better engages staff in improvement work, and engenders a greater trust among patients and service users. When there has been harm, people want to be told honestly what happened, to be supported, informed of what will be done, and to know what actions will be taken to stop this from happening again. That's why we have included a duty of candour provisions in part two of the bill. This will be a duty on organisations who provide health and social care to follow a duty of candour procedure where there's been an incident of physical or psychological harm. This will provide a further dimension to the role of organisations to support continuous improvements in the quality and safety culture across Scotland's health and social care services. This is one of a series of actions that should form part of organisational focus and commitment to learning and improvement. The duty of candour will apply to a wide range of health and care services across Scotland. Because it is an organisational duty, it won't apply to individuals providing services. It may be helpful if I explain the key steps of the duty. These key steps will be set out in regulations that will be made using the powers in the bill. When an organisation becomes aware that there has been an adverse event resulting in harm, it must ensure that those affected are notified that this has happened. An account of the facts of what happened should be provided. Organisations must offer support to the person harmed and to relatives and staff who have been involved with the event. Those affected must be informed of the further steps to be taken to review the event and be given the opportunity to have their questions considered by the review process. And finally, the organisation must also provide an apology and must confirm all of the actions taken in a written record. The contents of this will inform the regular public reports of disclosable events and organisational response of these. Must make progress. If you want to ask me a question in your speech, I'll happily answer them in the closing. Key to this will be an organisational role to ensure that all staff who are asked to be involved with a duty of candour procedure have access to the relevant training, supervision and support before, during and after their involvement. All organisations will be required to report publicly on the number and nature of the events that have been disclosed to people and confirm that requirements of the organisational duty of candour have been met. It is worth remembering that legislation forms only part of the duty of candour. In addition, we will produce guidance and national training resources to assist organisations in the implementation of the duty of candour. Many organisations will already have procedures in place for handling complaints or responding to adverse or significant events. And we consider that for most, the additional administrative demands of the duty of candour should be minimal. Part 3 of the bill creates offences of ill-treatment and willful neglect, which will apply to health and social care workers and provider organisations. The offence will cover intentional acts or omissions and are not intended to catch instances of mistake. I know that neglect and ill-treatment occur very rarely in our health and social care system, and these offences will allow the criminal justice system to identify and deal with these cases effectively and appropriately when they do arise. Since around 1913, there has been a criminal offence of willful neglect or ill-treatment of patients in mental health care, and I think it's right that the deliberate neglect or ill-treatment of anyone who receives health or social care should be dealt with in a similar way. The offences are intended to help to secure access to justice for those who suffer neglect or ill-treatment. There are two offences in the bill, one which covers health and social care workers and another which covers health and social care providers. These offences are not about catching people who are doing the best they can in their job. They are about dealing with those situations where someone wants to neglect or ill-treat another in their care and sets out to do so. I would like to emphasise the difference between the offences in this part of the bill and the unintended or unexpected incidents covered by the duty of candour, which I referred to earlier. The ill-treatment and willful neglect offences are intended to capture very deliberate acts or omissions. The duty of candour is about increasing openness and transparency where something unexpected or unintended has happened. The Scottish Government launched a consultation in September to explore the issues around extending the offence to children's health and social care services. We greatly value the input and expertise of our partners in the area of child protection. Following their input, I can confirm that I will not bring forward an amendment to extend the offence, and the response to the consultation will be published on December the 3rd. Presiding Officer, I look forward to the debate and ask Parliament to support this stage one at decision time this evening.
Many thanks. I now call on Duncan McNeill to speak on behalf of the Health and Sport Committee. 10 minutes or thereby. There's a little bit of time in hand, but not all that much.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. From adverts showing Ronald Reagan giving cigarettes as gifts at Christmas to Superman jumping out of a helicopter advertising cigarettes, long gone are the days when cigarettes were so fashionable that around half all UK adults were regular smokers. Decades later, whilst attitudes have drastically changed, cigarette smoking is still the world's leading cause of preventable poor health and premature death. In Scotland, tobacco use is associated with over 13,000 deaths and around 56,000 hospital admissions every year. A key part of this bill aims to tackle this further by making an offence to smoke within part of a designated no-smoking area around buildings and hospital grounds. Those caught smoking would be liable on summary conviction to a fine of up to £1,000. At present, all NHS hospital grounds are indeed no-smoking areas, and this bill would not change that. What it proposes to do is to enable no smoking areas around hospital buildings to be enforced by local authority officers. Currently, those people who refuse to comply with no smoking areas in hospital grounds can only be asked to leave those grounds or move on. And we all know that that has caused a great deal of concern to our constituents by our, you know, our casework, the objections, complaints, and indeed in the Green Rock Telegraph's campaign about the abuse of the no-smoking rule at Inverclyde Royal Hospital. And thankfully, not just locally, most witnesses agreed that smoking immediately outside hospital entrances and exits and outside windows should be an offence. However, as a committee, we had concerns about the feasibility of the government's approach to setting the same set distance, possibly 10 or 15 metres, from every hospital building as the enforceable part of a larger no-smoking area. We recommended that the Scottish Government reviews its approach and instead allow each health board area to propose its own legally enforceable perimeter. This would enable them to reflect on the different grounds and types of hospital in each board area. I note, regrettably, that the Minister disagrees with the committee's recommendation because the government considers that if NHS grounds each have different enforceable areas, this could lead to patients inadvertently committing an offence. However, I would seek the Minister's views on whether these same issues could not also arise under the government's proposed approach. For example, if the enforceable perimeter is indeed set at 10, 15 metres, then for some hospital, this could extend the fence to all the hospital ground, whilst for others, it could be a small part of the ground. Indeed, the enforceable perimeter could be less than 10 or 15 metres if an exempted site, such as a hospice, is co-located within the hospital. Presiding officer, another part of the bill introduced restrictions on the sale and advertising of nicotine and non-nicotine vaping products. None of us could have failed to have noticed the rapid increase of people using e-cigarettes, vaping pipes, hookah pens. I've no experience of these things, or whatever else they might be called. But we heard that there are currently 2.6 million people in the United Kingdom using NVPs. And our online survey received many comments of the benefits of using NVPs to reduce or stop cigarette smoking. However, research published today appears to suggest clearly that NVPs can help in smoking cessation and are, you know, indeed much less harmful than tobacco cigarettes. They may not completely be harmless. So we agree that more long-term research is needed. We agree with the bill and its proposals that nicotine vaping products should be treated as an age-restricted product, including restrictions on sales to over 18s. One area of debate was in relation to the powers in the bill which enable ministers to introduce additional restrictions on advertising to NVPs over and above those already in place at EU and UK level. The Scottish Government has confirmed it would intend to use these powers to restrict advertising of NVPs to the point of sale only. We supported this precautionary approach given the long-term evidence of using NVPs is still developing. I also welcome the Scottish Government's acknowledgement of our concern that a possible unintended consequence of implementing further restrictions on advertising in Scotland could be to provide a competitive advantage to those already existing NVP retailers. We welcome the Government's intention to monitor the potential risks of NVPs to be made more attractive to children through flavourings and point-of-sale advertising. Presiding officer, Part two of the bill focuses on the impact on people when mistakes arise in health and social care services. This part of the bill proposed to give health and social care and social work organisations a duty of candour. This means that when a person experiences or could have experienced an unintended or unexpected harm from their care unrelated to their illness or condition, then that organisation has a duty to tell them. Whilst many witnesses supported the duty of candour in the bill, we also heard evidence that there was no need for this legislation, given that there are long-standing professional and ethical duties which require candour or disclosure of harm. Whilst we recognise that these duties currently exist, the committee supported in its inclusion in the bill because it builds on existing good practice, but more importantly, because the duty will focus and apply to organisations. The duty of candour procedure will be set out in regulations which will be subject to negative procedure. These regulations will play a significant part in ensuring that the duty of candour procedure is implemented effectively. We therefore agree that this should be changed to become an affirmative procedure. In its response to the committee's report, the government disagrees. Given this, I invite the minister to consider further how the parliament might be given a greater opportunity to fully scrutinise these significant regulations when they are brought forward. The final part of this bill proposes to create new offences of ill treatment or willful neglect. One offence would apply to an adult health and social care workers, and the other would apply to adult health and social care providers. We heard concerns that the creation of these offences would work against the openness and honesty and candour that Part 2 of the bill seeks to create. The Minister clarified for us that this concern should not arise as it triggers for engaging the duty of candour that is unintended or unexpected harm, are separate and distinct from those which will trigger the offence of willful neglect or ill treatment. That is deliberate acts with a high level of intention. That said, we recognise training and education for all health and care staff will be key to the successful implementation of the procedures for the duty of candour and the new offences. Presiding Officer, this is a large, diverse bill, and I have not been able to do justice to all the committee's recommendations in the time allowed, but I would like to place on record the committee's thanks to all of those who provided written and oral evidence and gave of their time, and we look forward to scrutinising any amendments at stage two. Thanks.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Marra. A generous 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by clarifying the question that I wish to ask the Minister in her opening remarks, just so that she's very clear from the outset, as I would very much like an answer to it in her closing remarks today. But it's regarding the duty of candour that she was addressing. Minister, this touches on a situation which has been brought to my attention, especially over the last 6 months, about care workers being disciplined at the Scottish Social Services Council. There are several of these and an increasing number of disciplinary hearings for care workers at the Scottish Social Services Council. And this is because, as you know, there are more and more care workers employed because we have an ageing population. But currently these care workers who are being disciplined by the SSSC are not entitled by the Scottish Government to any legal aid whatsoever, and often appear at these tribunals completely unrepresented, as many of them are not members of trade unions and they're not entitled to legal aid through the government. They also have to pay their own travel expenses to these disciplinary hearings. And when I asked a parliamentary question on this, presiding officer, the Scottish Government said it doesn't keep records of the numbers of disciplinary hearings. I think there is a real overlap with the duty of candour and how it will impact on people's working rights and conditions. And I wanted to ask the Minister quite clearly, when this duty of candour and willful neglect comes in, will care workers be entitled to legal aid when they are being disciplined by the Scottish Social Services Council? And what is the overlap in that procedure? I just wanted to make that clear at the outset, presiding officer. Can I welcome this bill and its wide-ranging provisions and the steps that it will take to help improving public health across a range of areas? I will start my remarks, as the Minister and the committee convener have, by addressing the issue of e-cigarettes in our communities. Presiding officer, there's been an explosion of e-cigarettes and nicotine vapour use in the last couple of years, and becoming a very familiar sight in everyday life. Their popularity is undeniable, and I think it can only be a positive sign that people are looking for another way to stop harmful smoking. The sudden and huge rise in e-cigarettes demands this Parliament attention as we ensure that there is a legal and regulatory framework for them to be sold and used and brought into line with our approach to tobacco. And I think the proposals being put forward in this bill by the Government are sensible and measured, and they reflect the ongoing development of the evidence base on NVPs. And on that basis, we are happy to support them. And I notice the broad support, as articulated by Duncan McNeill, that they have gained from respondents to the Health Committee. But I do agree with the Health Committee that we must continue to be alive to the opportunities e-cigarettes present as a smoking cessation tool. And I welcome the Government and NHS Health Scotland's commitment to progressing this. The Minister recently told the Scottish Parliament that smoking has reduced in Scotland by 3% in the last year, in one of the last health debates that we had. And I would be interested to know from her research and evidence what role the e-cigarettes have played in encouraging that fall. I think it would be in Parliament's general interest to know if it has been market forces and the availability of e-cigarettes that have reduced harmful smoking, or if it is indeed public health campaigns, if she does have that information. We know that there are a range of views about the safety of e-cigarettes and their effectiveness as a way to reduce harmful smoking. Ash Scotland has said that vaping is less harmful than smoking, but not harmless. Cancer Research UK confirms that while they can help cut down or quit smoking, the reality is the full health effects are still unknown. But I'm also interested in the views of Public Health England, which cites emerging evidence that e-cigarette users have some of the highest successful quit rates, and that takes us to the whole debate about e-cigarettes on prescription. I certainly believe e-cigarettes represent a real opportunity towards the smoke-free Scotland to which this Parliament aspires and which the Minister very recently articulated. The 2034 target of reducing smoking to below 5% of the population is very ambitious, and while it is one I share, and I'm sure we all share, we will not deliver on it unless we take real action to deliver that cultural change. But while we gauge the evidence for the effectiveness of e-cigarettes in this pursuit, I welcome the cautious steps the Scottish Government has taken to tighten up the legislation around their sales. Presiding officer, perhaps with the delayed but ongoing work to the Scottish Government's refreshed cancer strategy to be published next year, we don't know before the election or after the election, but hopefully in that we will see a strong public health agenda which will reflect on how we can use e-cigarettes to reduce further harmful levels of smoking. I welcome also, presiding officer, the move to enforce the NHS's no smoking policy outside Hospital, another step, hopefully, on changing smoking culture in Scotland. Presiding Officer, on the care side of the bill, we generally support the aim of a more open and transparent system which gives greater protection to patients. And there is considerable support for the government's approach to introduce both a duty of candour and an offence of wilful neglect. And I hope this will allow healthcare workers and organisations to build on existing good practice and offer a uniform standard which gives certainty to patients and staff. There is obvious concern, though, Presiding Officer, especially among the RCN and the other professional bodies who represent health workers, and we must engage with them through the progress of the bill to reflect these worries and assuage them where possible. And for that reason, I am pleased that the government has committed to involving health and social care staff in drawing up the procedures, although I am slightly nervous that all of these procedures are being left to regulation, procedures which could have significant impact on nurses and care workers' working conditions and working rights. It slightly concerns me that they are being left completely to regulation and are not on the face of the bill, but I do think it's the right approach to involve health and social care staff in drawing them up. It's very important that we use their expertise to shape how we improve standards. And on that point, Presiding Officer, I would echo the committee convener's call that actually these regulations go through by affirmative procedure for the reasons I have outlawed, that they can affect or could affect nursing and health and care workers' working conditions and their working rights, and they should go through this Parliament by affirmative procedure and not by negative procedure. Presiding Officer, at this point, can I highlight and put on record our thanks to healthcare workers who do some of the most difficult, I think, physical and emotionally demanding jobs in our communities and allow our elderly and vulnerable to remain in their homes or support them in a care environment. Despite the high standards of the vast majority of carers and the work they do, there will always be examples where people fall below that level, as in every walk of life or profession, and where care is compromised. And it is right that we have a system of redress for those who suffer or are inconvenienced as a consequence. But we must also recognise that if we are to set higher standards for our care workers, then we have a duty to support them properly through better pay and conditions and improved training and support. Scottish Labour has already committed to paying a living wage to Scotland's care workers, and we must also investigate how we can better train and support care workers as we have rising and rising and rising expectations of their services and the trust we put in them to look after our vulnerable and elderly populations. And we must generally raise the esteem of the job of a carer. Presiding Officer, for too long our social care system has been treated like a second tier of our health system. And if we're going to move towards a regulatory system which echoes the high standards in our NHS, we must also acknowledge the duty of care to the care workers to help them in their professional development and pay them for a fair wage for the hard job that they do. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And before I call on Nanette Milne, I just want to let open debate speakers know that at the moment I'll probably be able to give you all up to 7 minutes for open debate speeches. So now call on Dr. Nanette Milne, up to 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's bill we're discussing today proposes three very important pieces of legislation: the development of policies around tobacco, nicotine and smoking in part one, to further the government's anti-smoking strategy, a proposed duty of candour in part two, and the introduction of new criminal offences of ill treatment and neglect in part three. Concerns were expressed by witnesses about all parts of the bill, and particularly about parts two and three, but by and large there was support for the policy intent of the bill and for its general principles, which should allow approval at stage one, although I have no doubt significant amendments will come forward at the following stages. As usual, the committee clerks have done excellent work in assimilating the evidence we received and in drafting the stage one report. But this time, I'm particularly grateful to them, as I missed some of the evidence-taking sessions because of illness. But at this time, at this point, Presiding Officer, I want to put on record my increasing concerns about the pressures being put on Parliament and particularly on members of the Health and Sport Committee as we approach the end of this parliamentary session. The Government's response to the Stage 1 Committee report came into my inbox just before 5 p.m. yesterday, and it really isn't possible with a full committee meeting, which today dealt with two other bills immediately preceding this debate, to give full and proper consideration to a late and lengthy paper. I know that with six health bills to deal with before the dissolution of Parliament, time is of the essence, but in a unicameral Parliament and with no available time for post-legislative scrutiny, we do need to give full consideration to primary legislation, and some of the pressure would, I think, be avoided if the Government could give us just a little more time to consider responses to our reports. I am aware I digress.
Maureen Watt.
I thank the Member for giving way on that point. She will, of course, know that in many cases, the Government's response does not come out before the Stage 1 report, and this reply to the Stage 1 report has in fact been very timely.
I do accept, I do accept the Minister's explanation, but I, having sat all day yesterday to get the report, I think I would have probably been better to ignore the information that came in. I'm just making a general point, actually, which I do feel quite strongly about. Presiding Officer, Part 1 of the bill was generally accepted by witnesses as the proposed controls and restrictions on the sale of nicotine vapour products or NVPs such as e-cigarettes more or less mirror current statutory restrictions on tobacco products. On balance, I think this is sensible because though it's accepted that NVPs do not have the same harmful effects on health as tobacco, the evidence base on long-term harm is still developing, and therefore a proportionate and balanced approach to their availability for sale seems wise, although they undoubtedly do have a place as a smoking cessation tool alongside trained support. The committee was concerned, however, that due to the current cost and complexity of registering an NVP as a medicinal product, it's unlikely that many of them will be registered as such, putting into question, I think, their use as smoking cessation aids. I hope the industry will actually pursue this matter further with the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. I also think it's prudent that retailers should have to register their intention to sell NVPs, although I think there may be some ongoing disagreement about whether there should be separate registers for the two types of product, or one which includes tobacco and NVP retailers, as the bill stipulates, or indeed one which covers those who sell all age-restricted products, as tentatively suggested by the committee. I know the Government intends to provide a clear separation between NVPs and tobacco products on the website where the register is held, because on current evidence, the former, as I've already said, are considerably safer than tobacco, and I think this will be welcomed. With regard to banning smoking in hospital grounds, I think it's right to introduce enforceable legislation, because although most, if not all, health boards already forbid smoking on their premises, and most people respect this, it isn't a statutory requirement. Whether the enforceable ban on smoking should be in an area defined by regulation as the same distance from all hospital buildings for all hospital grounds as proposed by the Government, or defined by each individual health board specifying its own legally enforceable perimeter as suggested by the committee, is, I think, likely to be further debated as the bill progresses through Parliament. And there is also discussion to be had about possible exemptions, particularly for mental health patients. But as I said at the outset, the general principles as proposed in Part 1 of the bill seem to be acceptable to most people who have engaged with the committee. Parts 2 and 3 of the bill are more controversial, with the Law Society, the BMA and the RCN amongst those expressing reservations about them. Those opposed to the duty of candour do not think that legislation is the way to create a culture of openness within the NHS, and emphasise that there are already requirements to be honest with patients about their treatment and any failings which occur. They feel that an apology for shortcomings will be more meaningful if it's given spontaneously, rather than as the result of a legally enforced duty. Also, because harm in this context is not specifically defined, they feel the duty is too broad and could encompass very minor events which it's not intended to cover.
Stuart Stevenson.
In relation to the issue of apologies, I wonder if the member would welcome, as I do, at section 23.2, which makes clear that the offering of an apology, a statement of sorrow or regret, does not constitute an admission of guilt and that is a key way in which we may see an increase in the spontaneous or planned offering of true comfort to those who may have suffered at the hands of a mistake.
Dr. Milne.
Indeed, I agree with the member on that, and I'd be very concerned if that wasn't actually stated within the legislation. A similar lack of definition is cited by opponents of the proposed new offences of willful neglect and ill-treatment levelled at healthcare professionals and organisations. Although as these terms are already established in Scottish law, I don't see this as a real problem. The Law Society of Scotland supports the policy intent of this part of the bill, but considers the offences may be unnecessary, as such actions will be covered under existing common law. It's also concerned that the introduction of the new offences may deter people from entering the social care professions, and so recommends that if the legislation goes forward, the offences should state that there must be actual injury, either physical or psychological, as a prerequisite to any criminal action. This, it is felt, would be a reasonable way of creating a sensible distinction between cases of poor care and criminal neglect, and I expect to hear more of this from the Law Society at stage two. Presiding Officer, I'm aware that in the time allocated to me, I've just skated over or ignored many of the important proposals in the bill, which no doubt will have more detailed scrutiny at stages two and three, assuming the general principles of the bill are accepted by Parliament at decision time this evening. We will be supporting the bill at this stage, and I look forward to further discussions with stakeholders as it proceeds through the next parts of the parliamentary process.
Thanks very much. We now move to the open debate speakers. As I said, we have a bit of time in hand. 7 minutes are there by Stuart Maxwell, to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Excuse me. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm glad to be given the opportunity to speak in today's debate on the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. Now, as members are aware, the bill contains four main proposals to introduce restrictions on the sale of nicotine vapour products, commonly known as e-cigarettes, to make it an offence to smoke in a designated area outside NHS hospital buildings, to create a legal requirement for health and social care organisations to inform people who have been harmed by their care or treatment, and finally, of course, to establish a new criminal offence of ill-treatment or willful neglect in health and social care settings. I'd like, if I can, to say a few words on each of these points, but I want to start by talking about e-cigarettes. Now, e-cigarettes are a relatively new product, and their use has grown very quickly indeed. Certainly, when we were doing the original smoking ban in this Parliament back in 2005, there certainly was no discussion of these cigarettes. They were basically an unknown product. They were indeed only introduced to the UK in 2006. In 2010, only 3% of adult smokers in Scotland had used an e-cigarette, but by early 2014, this had risen to some 17%. Now, due to the fact that they are a new product, there are no longitudinal studies to show the long-term impact of using e-cigarettes. I note that Public Health England have reviewed the available evidence and have concluded that vaping is safer than smoking and that it seems to support smoking cessation, with those who use NVPs having a higher success rate in stopping smoking than those who don't. But that, of course, doesn't mean that vaping is safe. We mustn't forget that it takes a long time for the damage caused by smoking to become evident. Men, indeed, started smoking during World War I, when cigarettes were handed out as rations to soldiers, and deaths caused by lung cancer didn't peak in men until the 1970s. Women in general didn't take up smoking until World War II, 20 years later, and deaths from lung cancer peaked and stabilised in women in the 1990s, 20 years later than men, and almost exactly the same time period had elapsed between when men had started to smoke and peak male lung cancer deaths as when women had started to smoke and maximum deaths from lung cancer in women. About 50 years. Given this information, I believe that the Scottish Government is wise to be cautious and to restrict and regulate the sale and marketing of e-cigarettes. I certainly support the recommendations to make it illegal to sell nicotine vapour products to those who are under the age of 18 and to provide the power to prohibit the sale of NVPs in vending machines. I'm also pleased that NVP retailers will require to be registered on the Tobacco and Nicotine Vapour Product Retailer Register, and that they must ask for proof of age before selling e-cigarettes to customers. It's vital with such a new product that we protect our children from any as yet unknown health problems which may appear over time. I do, however, agree with the committee that the Scottish Government should seriously consider asking the NHS to provide national guidance on the known risks and benefits of using NVPs to stop smoking, in order that people who are trying to stop smoking can make an informed choice as to which types of smoking cessation products they wish to use. I also support the government in its proposals to grant the power to restrict advertising of NVPs to the point of sale. This is a balance which can allow smokers some information about NVPs as a safer alternative to cigarettes, but will hopefully not attract new non-smoking customers. Now, paragraph 90 of the committee's report states, "We support the precautionary approach adopted by the Scottish Government in relation to advertising of NVPs, given the need to balance encouraging smokers to switch to NVPs as an aid to smoking cessation, whilst also not attracting new never-smoked NVP users." Now, I have to say, this is an area I am concerned about, because the process towards denormalising smoking in our society runs the risk of being stopped in its tracks by e-cigarettes. I think there is a risk here, a genuine risk, that the mere activity of vaping and using e-cigarettes could be seen as a, if you like, a route back into smoking. And I think I am concerned. I will in one moment. And I am concerned that much of the TV advertising and other advertising is in fact glamorising e-cigarettes and their use, and is an attempt to attract younger new non-smokers to take up e-cigarettes. I'll give way.
Mr. Maxwell has already quoted Public Health England, and in their review they said smoking prevalence has declined in adults and young people since e-cigarettes were introduced to the market. So that shows, I think, the opposite of what Mr. Maxwell is trying to say about the glamorisation, because e-cigarettes, since their inception, has actually seen the reduction in smoking prevalence.
Well, I have to say I actually disagree with the comments of my esteemed colleague from Aberdeen. And the reason I do that is because the process by which, if you look at the pattern that was adopted by tobacco companies over the years of how they tried to get new markets and how they used products and they used advertising, we're seeing exactly the same process being used today through e-cigarettes. Tobacco companies are buying up e-cigarette companies. They're producing their own e-cigarette companies. And they aren't doing it, you know, out of the goodness of their heart to get people off tobacco. That's not the reason they're doing it. And all I'm saying is I think we should be extremely cautious about this particular new product and be careful about it, seeing it as a panacea towards smoking. I don't think tobacco companies and big tobacco is on our side when it comes to e-cigarettes. Mm-hmm. Now, although the NHS in Scotland has a smoke-free policy across all of its grounds, there is no sanction that can be applied if someone refuses to comply. The bill proposes a designated no-smoking area around the buildings in NHS hospital grounds with a fine, as others have said, of £1,000, which can be applied to anyone who breaches that rule. Now, this means that the areas at which people congregate to smoke, the entrances to hospitals, which are, as we all know, are notoriously busy with smokers, would become smoke-free, I certainly hope. And people being admitted to hospital would not have to breathe in second-hand smoke as they were taken into hospital. And it would certainly, obviously, of course, be a benefit to visitors and NH staff as well. So I certainly support this change. I'm also aware that this measure would be welcomed by the general public, as government research commissioned in 2014 showed that 73% of Scottish adults supported the proposal that smoking on hospital grounds should be stopped. I'd now like to turn briefly to my attention to the other two proposals in the bill, namely to place a duty of candour on health and social care organisations and to establish a new criminal offence. Now, as we know, the NHS in England has been hit by a number of scandals, and there have been in England, as a consequence, a number of reviews into poor care and patient safety. These reviews recommended a need for honesty and candour with patients when things go wrong. The Scottish Government has therefore decided to give a duty of candour to responsible persons. I think, presiding officer, without revealing very much personal details of my own background, I have experience of a mistake which was caused by NHS staff and in my family, and all we sought was an apology. All we sought was an apology and an explanation and honesty. And at the time, all they were concerned about was whether or not we were going to sue them. And I think that is why this is important, that we get candour into this whole structure. Presiding officer, finally, I'd like to mention the last proposal to create a new offence of ill treatment or willful neglect. I think I very much welcome this proposal, as it provides protection for some of the most vulnerable people in our society. And in light of the fact that we have an ageing population, more of us are going to use care services. And so this is a measure that will ultimately benefit all of us. And I am delighted to be supporting this bill at decision time.
Many thanks. Now call Malcolm Chisholm to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Presiding Officer, we all support the ambitious target of the Scottish Government to reduce smoking in Scotland to 5% by 2034. But the simple fact of the matter is we are not making nearly fast enough progress. And I believe that, starting with the first part of the bill, the e-cigarettes have an important role to play in hastening that progress. The simple fact of the matter is that nicotine replacement therapy has never been popular. And the evidence from Professor Linda Bold, who's been researching tobacco control for nearly 20 years, and from Public Health England, is that e-cigarettes are far more effective in getting people off traditional cigarettes than other forms such as nicotine replacement therapy. So I think we need to look at the evidence on this, and it seems to me that Stuart Maxwell has not looked at the evidence from Public Health England or from Linda Bold. I recommend that he starts by looking at a 5-minute video from Linda Bold, which I put on my Twitter page today. And I think we need to look at the evidence on this and not foster scaremongering and myths. Now, I support the proposals in the bill on age restrictions and on vending machines that's related to that. But as Public Health England makes clear, there is absolutely no evidence that young people are becoming regular users of e-health. There is absolutely no evidence that they are a gateway to smoking, and there is absolutely no evidence that they're starting to renormalise smoking. So I really think we have to challenge those all too common myths in the population, because it is a danger to people's health. Why do you think organisations like Cancer Research UK support e-cigarettes? Because they know it can save lives. Now, I certainly believe also that I'm supporting what the provisions in the bill, because we don't want to glamorise the advertising of e-cigarettes, but we do want to have some advertising of them. I certainly support point of sale advertising, and I think we can have a debate at stage two about whether we possibly, it's not actually stage two because it's going to be in regulations, whether we need to go a bit further than that, because the Health Committee also says we want to, I quote, work with the Advertising Standards Authority to ensure harmonisation, and clearly they're going beyond point of sale advertising. Now, the Register also, I give way.
Minister.
Thank Malcolm Chisholm for giving way. Mr Chisholm will know that in order for the NHS to recommend NVPs as a smoking cessation product, they would have to be licensed, and e-cigarette companies have not asked for a license. Why does he think that is?
Dealt with that issue in terms of the complexities of that process. So that's certainly something that needs to be looked at. But I was beginning to talk about the Register, which is also widely accepted, but the Health Committee itself said there should be a Register for all age-restricted products. Linda Bold thought there should be separate registers. And interestingly, once again, Cancer Research UK don't want them on the Register at all because they are so concerned to separate cigarettes from e-cigarettes. And the fundamental fact here is, and this is coming from the Independent Scientific Committee on Drugs, drawing on experts from several different countries, have come to the conclusion that e-cigarettes are 95% less harmful than normal cigarettes. So let's look at what the experts are saying on this matter. Now, moving on to, can I just make one final point on that? Because I think also, being particularly interested in health inequalities, they have an important role in reducing health inequalities, because in terms of the people who are smoking in society, that is disproportionately, in many cases, those from more disadvantaged backgrounds. So I think they can also help in that regard. Now, moving on to smoking in hospital grounds, obviously I don't support the banning of e-cigarettes in hospital grounds, but I do believe that normal cigarettes should be banned, and I support the recommendations in the bill. But it's interesting that ASH actually supports the recommendation of the Health Committee that individual health boards should propose the legally enforceable perimeter. So I'm sure there will be more discussion about that at stage two. Now, moving on to the duty of candour, which, as we've already heard, is in the event of a person experiencing an unintended harm, the organisation has a duty to tell and support and review and apologise. So it was interesting at committee, those who supported it, we've heard about those who didn't support it or who questioned it, but Unison, for example, and Marie Curie supported it because they said it would drive culture change and support a culture of learning and improvement. So I think in principle, and certainly the committee in principle supported this. When we visited, some of us from the committee, Ardgowan Hospice and Greenock, they made an interesting point that some people might not want to know. And that's why I think we should have an amendment to the bill that introduces the English arrangement whereby you tell somebody that you have something to report but you give them the right to say, I don't want to know. I think that's the way to do it. It mustn't be done in a paternalistic way. You must say to people, we've got something to report, but they also must have the right to say, I don't want to know. So I think we should have an amendment to that effect at stage two. And also, of course, we need clear guidance on the triggers for the duty of candour and a programme of awareness-raising training and support. Now, finally, of course, is the offence of ill-treatment and willful neglect. Interestingly, in mental health legislation since 1913, but arising more recently because of the Mid-Staffs Inquiry and the Francis Report, and of course we are now putting into law something which is already in law in English health legislation. And clearly the difference here, if we're comparing it with the duty of candour, that this is something that is very deliberate. Duty of candour was to do with unintended harm. This is a completely different category. And although some people talked about their worries about the interaction of this new criminal offence with the duty of candour, the reality is that there should be no interaction because they're dealing with quite different categories. Now, as with the duty of candour, I think it's very important that we have guidance on how the new offence how the new offence will sit alongside existing processes and procedures, because some people have made the point that there already are some processes and procedures to prevent this happening. And we also, and the Health Committee asked for this, further information on training, support and education. So basically, the Health Committee is saying that we support the bill. I certainly support the bill. And the interesting thing is, going back to where I started on e-cigarettes, that though there is quite a big difference between those who are more positive about e-cigarettes and those who are more cautious, actually most people are still supporting the provision in the bill, although there might be some argument about the details. So in general terms, the bill, and including the provision on e-cigarettes, is something I would support. But I do think we need to put out a clear message about the evidence on e-cigarettes and the potential to stop people smoking and reduce health inequalities.
Many thanks. I now call on Kenny Gibson to be followed by Hans Alan Malik.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since becoming an MSP, I've taken a very keen interest in reducing harm caused by smoking. And indeed, in July 2001, I put forward the regulation of smoking well with the strong support of Dr. Richard Simpson, Bill Aitken, and Robert Brown. And this was taken forward subsequently after 2003 by Stuart Maxwell, and eventually the Scottish Executive, and ultimately led to the smoking ban being implemented in 2006. And for many years now, I've also been Deputy Convener of the Cross-Party Group on Tobacco and Health, which is led energetically and enthusiastically by Willie Rennie. And this is a cross-party group which, of course, aims to tackle the harm caused by tobacco use in Scotland, because it's an issue which has not gone away. And we heard from the convener of the Health and Sport Committee just how many people actually still die and become ill through tobacco use. Of course, behaviours and attitudes towards tobacco and smoking have varied wildly over the years, and earlier today I watched a programme on BBC iPlayer entitled Time Shift, The Smoking Years, which charts the history of tobacco use in the UK, explaining the initial hostility to tobacco through to widespread use, mass consumerism, class status, addiction, medical concerns, and modern public smoking bans. It's clear that despite long history and our familiarity with the smoker, our attitudes towards tobacco and smoking continues to evolve, along with understanding of this particular drug, how it is marketed, and its health and economic effects. And despite overwhelming evidence that smoking directly causes heart disease, cancers, and a host of other life-threatening illnesses, smoking remains the biggest cause of preventable death in Scotland. And of course, we know that for the tobacco companies, young people taking up smoking allows them to continue to be able to market as other older users either pass away or give up the habit. Of course, along with the smoking ban and other measures, the number of adults who identify smokers, I'm pleased to say, continues to fall in Scotland and has dropped to 28% of the population a decade ago to 22% last year. This is heartening, and my understanding is that many smokers actually smoke less than they did before, obviously, no doubt due to more restrictions on the places where they can actually smoke. This clearly represents solid progress towards the Scottish Government and indeed everyone, I believe, in this chamber's ambition of establishing Scotland as a smoke-free nation by 2034. And as has been pointed out by Jenny Mara, this has an ambitious target such that only 5% of the population then, we would hope, will smoke or indeed less. As we're aware, when government intervention closes down certain avenues or restricts how tobacco products are sold and marketed, the ever-innovative tobacco industry reacts in very creative ways to ensure they protect their margins. We've seen, for example, wholesale and unadulterated marketing to developing countries still being pushed by tobacco companies who claim that they're only interested in switching brand, not in actually encouraging younger people to smoke, something which anyone who looks at what's happening overseas can see is actually fundamentally dishonest. When advertising displays were banned, companies massively increased the variety of cigarettes they sold in order that their brands would take up entire shelves behind kiosks. And when smoking in public was banned, some companies even tried to relaunch snuff, somewhat unsuccessfully, although my wife, who's an MP, tells me it's still free to members of the House of Commons as a product to be enjoyed socially. Actually, the Minister smiling as her son is also a member of the Westminster Parliament. In recent years, we've witnessed an increase in nicotine vapour products as many smokers wish to switch, understandably, to a potentially less harmful method of receiving nicotine they crave. And whilst I personally consider that NVPs cannot be worse than a cigarette packed with thousands of harmful chemicals, the science to ascertain how safe they are remains sketchy and incomplete. And for that reason, it is incredibly important that we proceed cautiously to ensure a new generation of smokers is not created, assuming that the new pursuit is completely benign. And in this, I agree entirely with the contribution of my colleague, Stuart Maxwell. Considering that majority of high school children have been exposed to NVP marketing, it is clear we must ensure they are protected. And for this reason, I am pleased that following a public consultation, the Scottish Government has taken action to restrict the sale and advertising of such products. Prohibiting the sale of NVPs to anyone under 18, as well as making it an offence to purchase NVPs on behalf of someone under 18, will help limit the supply of such products to young children and lays down an important marker showing that these products may not be safe and for the time being must be considered along with the sale of alcohol and tobacco. As of cigarettes, I'm glad that this government has included measures to prevent the sale of NVPs from vending machines, introducing another hurdle to people who seek to purchase them under the legal age. Further to this, those who wish to sell NVPs must register on the tobacco retail register as they would to sell cigarettes, and this will introduce accountability for shopkeepers and help weed out the less scrupulous who would happily sell to people underage. As I mentioned, it may be that NVPs are relatively safe and could prove to be useful tools to help people stop smoking completely, and I'm sure colleagues in the Chamber would agree with that. However, until this can be proven conclusively, I believe the Scottish Government is right to take an evidence-based and precautionary approach to the marketing of such products which can ultimately lead to addiction. Now, regarding the duty of candour, Presiding Officer, as we've just heard from Malcolm Chisholm, Marie Curie, Unison, and indeed others such as Action Against Medical Accidents, Citizens Advice Scotland, and other support legislation to drive culture change and help to ensure the organisations do shift towards learning, improvement and disclosure of harm. And again, I echo Stuart Maxwell. I also have had experience of this. My son died as a direct result of medical neglect, and when one pursued an apology and measures to ensure that this didn't happen to anyone else, I'm afraid that was not forthcoming, and I think it quite appallingly in actual fact, and I would hope that such a duty would actually change the way health boards and others actually deal with such matters. Along with measures outlined in the tobacco control strategy, I believe the bill being debated today will help to further reduce the number of smokers in Scotland, protecting the health of our citizens and ultimately lead Scotland towards smoke-free status in the years ahead. And finally, Presiding Officer, I would like to say that I very much look forward to Jackson Carlaw's closing speech for the Conservatives. I received this ballot paper for the West of Scotland regional list just a few short days ago for the Conservative ranking, and a very good speech from him could possibly influence my vote. Thank you.
I'm at a loss for words. I now call on Hanzala Malak to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and good afternoon to you. When speaking in today's debate on stage one of the Tobacco, Nicotine and the Care Bill, which is an extensive bill covering many different aspects of health and care. I am mainly going to focus on the tobacco and nicotine sections of the bill and the nicotine wiper products, also known as NVPs in particular. As NVPs are a relative new product that appears to be a general consensus on two points. One, that the evidence based relating to long-term harm of using NVPs is in its early stages. And two, that they do not have a role to play in helping people stopping smoking. Therefore, more evidence on the product harm from NEPs is needed. I strongly support the call by the Health and Sports Committee for more information from the Scottish Government on how to support research in this area. I also agree with the committee's recommendation that the Scottish Government to consider that the National Health Service should provide a national guidance on risk and benefits of using NVPs to stop smoking. We need to learn from our mistakes that society made with cigarettes. Regarding NEPs, should not be treated as the same as tobacco, as they are not, as harmful. But we need to ensure that not as harmful message is not confused with people thinking that they are safe. I believe that there is a need for we need to be careful with allowing advertising of NVPs to confuse people. NVP advertisement should target existing smokers and not try to increase those using such products. In the early days of cigarettes, you could find advertisements stating that they can be used as slimming aids. So instead of eating between meals, you should have a cigarette in order to stay fit and not fat. Now, cigarettes can suppress your appetite, so the advertisement was not totally lying, but it was confused with the use of used images to make smoking look glamorous. Members of my own family have had serious illnesses, problems as a result of smoking. But at the time they began to smoke, we did not know the risks to our health. As time went on, the evidence about the risks of tobacco grew. But by that time, it was hard for them to give up smoking. As I said before, we should not repeat the mistakes of our past, and we need to take a cautious approach to these products, still considering submitting to whether they are in fact harmful or not. There needs to be monitoring of the risks of making sales of NVPs as an alternative and to ensure that people's safety isn't protected. The Scottish Government needs to ensure that people have the fullest and clear information presented to them so that they can make that choice. And I hope that the belief that this bill goes some way in ensuring that that is the case. Presiding Officer, I have had constituents write to me about the high rates of smoking amongst people with mental health problems. I understand that smoking is also falling at a slower rate amongst these people. We can see people moving from smoking to long-term use of NEPs as an alternative. I personally know of one person who has been vaping for a number of years, and at times of stress, he has had two or even three VAPs sticking out of his mouth. Of course, it is that person's choice to do such a thing. But it demonstrates issues we have not tested. Hence, I wish the committee speed in researching these issues in a bid to protect our citizens. Presiding Officer, the other thing I wish to say is that we know for a fact that smoking affects our health detrimentally. Many of our citizens face very serious health problems as a result of the taking cigarettes. Unfortunately, many of them smoked when we didn't have the research available to us. However, now we see a new trend in our communities where NBPs are being introduced, particularly to our young, which is very disturbing. And I think it's absolutely crucial that we have legislation in place that protects our young. And I think it's also absolutely essential that people, regardless of age, actually know the facts of taking NBPs and the dangers that they may cause to themselves in the short term and possibly in the long term. So, Presiding Officer, once again, I wish the committee every success in their deliberations, and I wish that the Minister will also indicate what support she can lend the National Health Service in trying to find some resources for additional research. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. I now call on Kevin Stewart to be followed by Jim Hume.
Presiding Officer, first of all, the confession. I was a smoker. I started smoking at age 14. It was not because of any advertising. It was not because of parental influence, because they did not smoke. It could be a bit of peer pressure, but I was never given to that either. But I did start smoking at the age of 14. I've given up many times over the years, sometimes for long periods of time. On Christmas Eve last year, I bit the bullet and decided to quit the fags again. I decided to give up cigarettes because I began to cough in the mornings and felt that smoking was being rather detrimental to my health. At that point, Presiding Officer, I switched to electronic cigarettes. And in my opinion, these nicotine vapour products, as they are described as in the bill, have in the main kept me on the straight and narrow and away from cigarettes since Christmas Eve last year. I have to admit that I still have cravings for cigarettes on almost a day and daily basis, and today is not being particularly helpful in that regard. But while I managed to quit previously by going cold turkey, I always ended up returning to cigarettes. There's little doubt in my mind, Presiding Officer, that electronic cigarettes have helped me quit my 20-plus a day cigarette habit, have allowed me to cut down on my nicotine intake, and I have to say that I feel much healthier than I did prior to the 24th of December last year. I'm not alone in that regard. In its systematic review of e-cigarettes, the Cochrane Library found that almost 1 in 10 smokers using e-cigarettes had been able to quit smoking up to 1 year later, and that around 1/3 had cut down smoking. The trial data showed no adverse effects from short to medium term use of e-cigarettes. I firmly believe, that while young people should be discouraged from smoking and vaping, adult vapers who are using e-cigarettes to quit or cut down their smoking should not be demonised for their efforts. One of my constituents wrote to me recently because he was scared of a possible vaping ban. And he said, "I used to smoke, but I haven't had a cigarette since the 1st of October 2014. Notice how we all remember the dates here when we quit. I started with the white e-cigs, now I'm on to more complicated mods and tanks. I stopped smoking because I have angina and vaping seems to be okay in the terms that I can breathe easier." The provisions contained in this bill to introduce a minimum purchase age of 18 for MVPs, to prohibit sales from vending machines, for dealer registration and for advertising restrictions do not bother me one iota. However, we have already seen attempts in this Parliament to demonise those who are using electronic cigarettes,
with some suggesting that these devices are the alcopops of the nicotine world. Based on scant evidence, and of course this Parliament banned the use of e-cigarettes on the campus on the basis that they were following the precautionary principle. Could this be construed as demonising people for their efforts to try and quit smoking? Could this be construed as demonising people for their efforts to try and quit smoking? I hope not. I intend to support this bill at stage one, but would have grave concerns if any attempts were made to restrict vaping at stage two. And I hope that colleagues will not try to use this bill to try and achieve other ends. In relation to the folk that have suggested e-cigarettes have renormalised smoking, this runs counter to the review which I mentioned earlier in response to Mr. Maxwell that was carried out by Public Health England, which stated that smoking prevalence has declined in adults and young people since e-cigarettes were introduced to the market. Like everyone else in this chamber today, Presiding Officer, I want to see smoking prevalence continue to decline. But I have a fear that if the next target is vapours, then that decline will not be as rapid as we would wish. And you may well see some people moving back on to cigarettes if they have to do the things that smokers currently have to do. And there have been some things which I would like to pick up on from today's debate, from my own personal experience, because while some folk have indicated that they feel that the smoking ban has led to people cutting down on their smoking, I have to say that my own experience is somewhat different, because when I was a smoker, I had no problem about going outside or doing all of the rest of the things which we have become quite used to. But one of the things which happened at that point was when you were going outside, you didn't go outside just for one, you would end up having two cigarettes in a row, which actually increased the intake of nicotine that I was getting at that particular point in time, and certainly added to the bill for cigarettes. Finally, Presiding Officer, in terms of the ban in hospitals and hospital grounds, I've got absolutely no problem with that happening. However, I do think that there is a need somewhere on these grounds, well away from entrances, well away from other people, for patients, some patients, to be able to go and smoke rather than to see them signing themselves out of hospital at a time where they require treatment. Or, of course, the other alternative, Presiding Officer, is to allow them to vape. Thank you.
Many thanks. I call Jim Hume to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we should congratulate all the members of the committee for their hard work and, of course, the clerks on this report. We're again looking at a bill. It has the potential to help a lot of people live healthier lives with better guidance and, I think, better support. It's three main provisions on NVPs, vaping, duty of candour and ill treatment and neglect could be beneficial, of course, in principle. However, we need to look at each one in depth and distinguish what's beneficial and what could end up being undesirable and perhaps impractical. So I'd like to point out a few of the issues that I believe require some more evidence, as well as a better understanding of what the assumed policies aim to do. So some members have already pointed out that the move towards limiting the sale and advertising of nicotine vapour products, while the move towards restricting products that are harmful is welcome, there's a large number of evidence, and we've just heard some from Kevin Stewart, received stating the fact that they are less harmful than cigarettes. And of course, we know that they are a good way of weaning people off smoking tobacco. And there's little doubt that smoking tobacco is worse for you than vaping cigarettes. But there is concerns, of course. Nicotine is a poison. It used to be used as an insecticide. It is an addictive chemical. It does affect your cardiovascular system. and it can even lead to birth defects. That's all well documented, nicotine by itself. So there is concerns that there is some targeting of non-smokers, and of course under 18-year-olds you would hope would be non-smokers, so supportive of the government's proposals there. And we also know that there's been targeting, even at football matches, where they've been giving e-cigarettes away. So there is concerns, and I fully appreciate Kevin Stewart and others' views and support them that, you know, that we need vaping to help people wean off the more harmful smoking of tobacco. So, but they're probably not harmless, I'm afraid. We don't have enough evidence. So there's a very fine line between what the bill seeks to promote as a better alternative to smoking for those who already smoke and what unintentional consequences if it could potentially have in promoting NPVs as something attractive to those who don't smoke, or as some witnesses put it, glamorised products, particularly to those under 18. Members will be aware of my member's bill going through Parliament at the moment. It aims to raise the awareness of damage caused by respiratory system of children because of second-hand tobacco smoke. Similarly, as we're not yet aware of the long-term impact on lungs from inhaling vapes, preventing a larger-scale problem from occurring is what a wise health policy should look like. So I'm supportive. And I do believe the measure to prohibit sales of NVPs to under 18s, just, is a reasonable step. We know that there's a lack of robust research and evidence in this area, so it's, I think, better to err on the side of safety in protecting young people. And I think Stuart Maxwell's evidence on that and the length of time it takes for cancers to appear from smoking cigarettes to actually the first time people start was good evidence enough. So I think we also have to consider the growing vaping market as well and the word-of-mouth reputation these products obtain among under-18s. I think it's a sensible measure, therefore, and one supported, of course, by numerous organisations, including Cancer Research UK. I'm also supportive of the provisions which build on the Lib Dem Labour coalition legislation with regard to smoking bans, which Stuart Maxwell was very much involved in at the beginning. At that time, the BMA chairman said, and I quote, the day would be remembered as the time Scotland took a bold and politically courageous step. So this measure takes this step further to protect the hospital areas, of course, health centres, GP practice grounds, other areas where health is promoted, and puts Scotland closer to the tobacco-free generation by 2034 that Malcolm Chisholm mentioned. I want to move on to another element of the bill, though, that of the duty of candour, which, while I believe will provide better emotional support to patients, I think we must ensure its use is balanced against its necessity. And looking to the professional opinion of the BMA, I was informed that this measure could have the potential to add administrative burdens, costs and responsibilities to health boards and GP practices. And rather, what the BMA is pointing out in the procedure is that, and I'll quote from them, any incident which occurs should be seen as an opportunity for improvement and learning. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, we know that doctors, nurses, consultants and every single medical and clinical member of staff wants to help their patients and is looking out to provide the best care to them. It's, after all, a basic element of the Hippocratic Oath for new doctors, as well as an element of the General Medical Council's standards and ethics guidance. So while I welcome the awareness this bill raises for the duty of candour, I think we must look to further information on how it might affect the relationship between practitioners and patients. Likewise, Deputy Presiding Officer, Part 3 of the bill makes provisions for introducing offences of willful neglect and ill treatment for healthcare professionals and organisations. So I'll reiterate the previous point that I made, that medical personnel do not seek to harm the patients. I would tread very carefully on this point as it moves forward the various stages of the bill. So in summing up, I'd like to ask the Minister for a number of specifications on the matter given the current context that practitioners work in. We know that health boards and subsequently doctors, nurses, A&E departments are squeezed very tight financially. We just recently saw health boards borrowing from the Scottish Government to break even, so departments are understaffed, staff's overworked and targets are pressing, so I'd be grateful in summing up if the Minister could address concerns that health professionals and care workers wouldn't be unduly criminalised for any failings.
My concerns are also echoed by the British Medical Association. Its concerns also focus around the issues that by imposing these types of sanctions, we may still not be solving the serious failings in healthcare delivery in Scotland, as they say, and adding a criminal offence would not provide any additional protection for patients, unquote. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to see that we're advancing in promoting patient care and health even further. And to further make this bill reach a more optimal result, we need to look at its provisions a little bit more closely and build upon its more constructively to the future. So, thank you.
Many thanks. I now call John Mason to be followed by Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And first, I would like to very much welcome the progress that has been made in smoking by the Scottish Parliament, including members here present. When it comes to smoking, I do think we want to get a balance between the health benefits for the public as a whole, and that obviously includes the smokers themselves, but also allowing people the freedom to do themselves a bit of harm if they are determined to do so. Given that we've had some personal stories here this afternoon, I'll just mention the fact my own grandfather started smoking, I think, in the First World War and lived till he was 86, which encouraged my father to also smoke heavily, which he did to the tune of 40 a day. But unfortunately, it did have a negative impact on his health and life. I myself am slightly perhaps more relaxed about smoking. I allow people to smoke in my car if they want. I was brought up with smoke in the house, smoke in the car, smoke everywhere. So I kind of am reasonably relaxed about it. I did try it myself briefly in my teens and did get the nickname at one stage of Smokes at school. However, I think that was a little unfair because I really had only tried one or two. But I do accept that it's not always an easy balance to strike. And on the one hand, we can be accused of being a nanny state and interfering too much in people's lives. But on the other hand, we can be accused of standing on the sidelines while people destroy the lives of themselves and their children. So I would like to concentrate today in part one of the bill, and especially on tobacco and e-cigarettes. Like other members, I assume I have received a fair amount of material from businesses telling me what a good thing e-cigarettes are. And I would have to say I have a number of friends and obviously colleagues who take that view as well. Now, I'm happy to accept that for some people who are trying to give up traditional cigarettes, then e-cigarettes can be a helpful way of doing that. But I think my main concern is at the other end of the spectrum, where e-cigarettes are clearly being used by unscrupulous companies as a way to entice people to start smoking with the hope that they will become hooked and move on to tobacco products. Members may know the Ford Shopping Centre at Parkhead, which is right beside my constituency office. And often I go in there on my way to get lunch at a well-known sandwich shop. And on the way, I passed various shops and stalls, and one in particular struck me when it was set up. And this is a stall right in the middle of the thoroughfare where the shoppers have to cram to get past. And it is a larger-than-life 3D model of a cigarette. I guess it's 20 times the size of a normal cigarette. And if you look at it, it looks exactly like a normal cigarette. But that stall is advertising e-cigarettes. But clearly, to me, that huge model of the cigarette is there to glamorise and encourage smoking. They may not technically be advertising tobacco products, but in practice, that is exactly what they are doing. As I said, I'm not arguing that e-cigarettes have no benefits, but I would argue that they are also being used as a thin veneer for advertising tobacco and traditional cigarettes. Especially this is a concern as children are being targeted in this way. The BMA also highlight this in their submission for today's debate. And if I can just quote a little bit out of their submission. Concerns have been expressed by BMA members over the use of marketing methods to promote e-cigarettes, which are likely to appeal to children, young people and non-smokers. The BMA is also concerned that e-cigarette marketing may have an adverse impact, reinforcing conventional cigarette smoking habits, as well as indirectly promoting smoking and increasing the likelihood of young people starting to smoke. Overall, I find myself very much in agreement with the committee's recommendations, and in particular with paragraph 90, which has already been quoted by Stuart Maxwell. On the question of smoking in hospital grounds, We spent a fair bit of time on this at the Finance Committee, looking at the potential costs in the financial memorandum. On the overall principle, I very much agree with the proposal that if we want to continue to change the culture in smoking, then where else would be a higher priority than on the grounds of the National Health Service? But I do take the point in the report at paragraph 117 that by having a two-tier system, there may be less adherence in the grounds beyond the legally enforceable limits, and there may also be confusion as to what is and where it is allowed and not allowed. The FM provides for signage costs at all hospitals, and time will tell whether that is sufficient. On the question of enforcement, when the ban on smoking in public places was introduced, I myself was a councillor at that time in Glasgow City Chambers and really was concerned that a lot of enforcement activity would be required to stop smoking in pubs, restaurants and similar places. And I have to say that I'm delighted that I was proved wrong and that that legislation came into effect so smoothly. Now, I note in paragraph 124 of the committee report, it says, if I just find it, the Scottish Government confirmed that it expected compliance by the public, patients and staff with the enforceable no smoking areas to be as high as with previous smoke-free legislation. And I have to say, I find that a little bit optimistic. I think there is a bit of a difference between being inside a restaurant or a pub where there's a lot of public opinion right on top of you and standing outside, perhaps on your own, in the grounds of a hospital. On the Finance Committee, we received submissions from local authorities in COSLA worried about the potential costs of the new legislation and whether the financial memorandum adequately provides for these. Therefore, we do say in our report on the FM, the lead committee may wish to seek further clarification of whether additional funding would be made available in the event that evidence indicates an increase in the cost of enforcement, either in respect of the sale of NVPs or of smoking in hospitals. And I'm glad to see at paragraph 131 in the main report that the committee takes that up and says we therefore welcome the government's commitment to consider any breakdown of costs provided by COSLA should there be a short-term increase in enforcement costs. So overall, presiding officer, this country has clearly made progress in the subject of smoking, but we want to continue making that progress. And we also need to protect the ground won against attempts to undermine it by the tobacco industry. Therefore, I very much welcome this bill, and I suspect it will not be the last on this topic. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Dennis Robertson to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think it's interesting that a lot of focus has been taken on the part one of this bill. I make no apology for perhaps putting a lot of my attention to the part one of the bill this afternoon. I think it's also interesting that we're hearing confessions from colleagues, but it puts things into context for me, Presiding Officer. Because if we're making attempts to try and have a healthier Scotland, which we are, smoking in itself, and I take on the board what John Mason has said, that it's about choice and balance. But I think if we have to achieve our objectives of 2034, 5%, we've got a long way to go. So we need to take some measures. And I think the measures Yeah, absolutely.
Stuart Stevenson.
I wonder whether we're correct to use the word choice. I think where addictions are concerned, it is precisely that you are absent from choice because that health issue denies you the choice to deprive yourself of the material you're addicted to, in this case, nicotine.
Dennis Roberts.
That's a very interesting approach from the member. I still believe, to some extent, although when it becomes habitual, there is still that element of choice which can, to some extent, with the appropriate treatments, etc., enable the person to move from the addiction. So I'm not quite sure that choice is still not available to a person, presiding officer. But in terms of the evidence that we do have, and Malcolm Chisholm mentioned Professor Bald from Stirling University, and Professor Bald has stated with the evidence that those who are using non-vapor products, nicotine vapor products, are 60% more likely to quit smoking. 60%, presiding officer. Now, for me, that is a substantial number. And if the e-cigarettes themselves can aid a person to stop smoking, and someone who was addicted from age 14 to last Christmas Eve, I think there is some evidence to suggest that it's perhaps a method that even things like people using other nicotine products, such as pads, etc., and chewing gums, if the e-cigarette in itself is enabling such a high percentage of people to remain off cigarettes, then I think there's something very positive from these products. However, we still don't know, because they are so new to us, that if they have a long-term effect. And this is something that I think that we need to keep in mind and obviously monitor for the future. And I sincerely hope that, because I think Stuart Maxwell made a very important point, that a lot of these e-cigarettes are now being produced by tobacco companies. Now, it may just be that they're switching from the tobacco to the nicotine vapor products for profit, but as he suggested, there may be some alternative side effect to this as well. With regard to the exposure, we do know that e-cigarettes have been, in relation to children, there has been certainly the advertising, and there's been a great deal of exposure to the e-cigarettes, and there has been an uptake. And this is something that we need to be very guarded about. So I certainly welcome the fact that we're going to be legislating against advertising just to the point of sale, which I think is incredibly important. And certainly when we're taking evidence at committee, presiding officer, there was a lot of discussion around this. And one of the areas in terms of point of sale, which I support, is that within the sort of community pharmacy, where, again, I think people can actually maybe take advice with regard to the product. Now, the Minister has suggested earlier that obviously it's not a medicine as such, because it's non-licensed, and that is certainly correct. But I sincerely hope that community pharmacy at the point of sale with the nicotine vapor products will be able to give appropriate advice on their use as a product with regarding to stopping smoking. We have taken certain other measures, which is maybe not in the bill itself, but I mean the government have continued to take measures to encourage people to stop smoking, and it was certainly supported when the minister launched a Take It Right Outside in October of this year. And again, that was supported by the British Heart Foundation, and James Cant, who is the director of BHF, had said at that point in time that just opening a window doesn't protect your children from secondhand smoke, that you've got to take it right outside. Now, of course, I'm sure James Cant and many of us who are non-smokers would actually prefer if people stop smoking entirely. But if those who are smoking can take it right outside, much the better. And this brings me on to the hospital and the hospital areas. A lot of discussion was in committee about the different hospital campus areas. And obviously, having a sort of smoke-free area, 10, 15 metres, whatever, it may not be able to be applied throughout the different campus because of the structural aspect of some of the hospitals. So we are a bit concerned of actually putting down this sort of parameter. And although the hospitals at the moment, and quite rightly so, I believe, have got a policy of non-smoking within their hospital grounds, including medical centres, I actually believe that in itself is the best way to go, with the possible exemptions where there is situations where indeed hospice or indeed certain areas of proven mental health benefits for someone within a particular area. Presiding officer, I think we have to also look at points 2 and 3 of this bill. And a duty of candour for me is about openness and transparency. It's about putting your hand up. It's about saying, hey, I made a mistake. That's okay. And I think people recognise that if something has happened, an error, we're OK about that. It's when something is actually covered up, when we try to cover up these mistakes, that is when the problem occurs. So this duty of candour for me is appropriate and proportionate within this bill. The willful neglect area on part three, I think in terms of legislation for this, again, I think is right and proper. And maybe just my final point, presiding officer. Jenny Mara began her contribution with a question with regarding SSSC and the disciplinary aspects. Now, obviously, this bill is not enforced as yet. And if there is a situation that persons are facing disciplinary action through SSSC, can I say of someone who used to manage in the care sector and had occasions to take people through disciplinary to SSSC, is a very rigorous thing. But it is there not to punish, it is there to identify whether or not a person has created or has been taken forward by their management because of disciplinary action.
Mr. Robertson, could you conclude, yeah, please?
So I would just be wary of trying to assign the SSSC and disciplinary alongside this bill. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. James Kelly, to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to take part in this Stage 1 debate and thank the committee and the clerks and various people that have given evidence at this stage. I think it's actually been quite an interesting debate this afternoon. You know, we've had some differences of opinion and people have brought their own personal experiences to bear. I've actually come to this relatively fresh because I'm not a member of the committee. And I actually had an open mind on e-cigarettes or NVPs, as they are known, coming into this debate. And as the debate developed, it's been quite interesting. I was quite persuaded by some of the points that Stuart Maxwell was making in terms of cautioning on the use of e-cigarettes and some of the promotional activities of the companies. I then listened to my colleague Malcolm Chisholm. I also always listened very carefully to Malcolm Chisholm, and he obviously pointed out it's important to look at the evidence. So I did actually look through the Stage 1 report and look at some of the evidence, and I noted from Ash Scotland's submission that there are 2.6 million people using e-cigarettes, and, you know, 1.1 million of them were using it as a vehicle to move off smoking, as were the other. I mean, bottom line was 2.5 million people, it seemed to be, from that evidence, seemed to be using it as a vehicle to come off traditional tobacco products, which would seem to back up, you know, what Malcolm Chisholm was saying. But, you know, I still... I stand by some of the cautionary comments that Stuart Maxwell and also John Mason were making in terms of some of the activities that these companies use to promote e-cigarettes. I note the arguments that various members have made about how important they are in terms of allowing people to come off traditional tobacco products. And Kevin Stewart, he's not here, but he obviously gave personal effect to that, but I think we do have to, it's early days yet, and we do have to be wary of the evidence. Yeah, sure.
Duncan McNeill.
This issue, did you take note of Professor John Britton, who from the UK Centre for Tobacco and Alcohol, also a lung specialist, who said in the evidence to the committee previously that vapour NVPs have got the potential of saving tens of thousands of lives, and the real enemy is tobacco, and nicotine is about as hazardous as caffeine.
James Kelly.
Thank you for that intervention, and I take on board that point, and what I would say is that I acknowledge the overall benefits of e-cigarettes and allowing people to wean off traditional tobacco products, but ultimately, bringing it back to the provisions of the bill, you know, why do we have to limit sales? Why do we need a register? Why do we have restrictions in relation to vending machines? Ultimately, e-cigarettes, there's still a tobacco product there, and it would be better for your general health if you were not smoking either e-cigarettes or traditional products. In relation to the bans on smoking in designated areas at NHS grounds, obviously I support that. You know, it's always seemed quite odd when you go to hospitals in recent times since the smoking ban's been introduced throughout the country that you see a lot of people outside smoking. And I was taken again by Kevin Stewart's comment, I'm not a smoker. And he said that when you go outside to smoke, you don't just have one cigarette, you have two. I wasn't even aware of that, you know. So, again, you know, people being able to smoke outside hospitals and encourages that, and it mitigates against the overall aim of reducing, you know, reducing reliance on tobacco. I do think there are some, you know, practical considerations to be taken into account there. Obviously, if you've got a strict designated no-smoking area where it's an offence, and then you've got other areas where there's a no-smoking policy but it's not an offence, you know, people will soon get wise to that, and there might be some difficulties in implementing this. Also interested in terms of going back again to NVPs and the fact that it will be down to individual health boards to decide the policy in relation to whether NVPs or e-cigarettes can be smoked outside hospitals. Again, I have to be honest, I'm not totally comfortable with the idea that we're trying to stop people smoking outside hospitals, but we might allow them to smoke e-cigarettes. I'm not persuaded by that argument. In relation to some of the other provisions in the bill, the duty of candour, I think that makes absolute sense. The points people have made about being open and transparent are correct. I would agree with what Kenny Gibson and Stuart Maxwell said. Some of the constituency cases I get, there's almost a defensiveness from the NHS that if they feel that there's a danger that they're going to get sued, they almost won't. You know, they won't communicate with you properly, and I think that's wrong. I think if something goes wrong in a situation where people are vulnerable, we do owe it to them to be open and transparent, and we do owe it to them to give an apology where that's appropriate. Again, on the criminal offences, I think that is also correct. I think some people have said it's a there's a potential clash there with the duty of candour, but I think the provisions in the bill are quite specific around ill treatment and willful neglect. And I think it also places particular onus on care providers, and I think that is important. I think there are some other issues to be dealt with in the care sector around training of care staff, and I think also appropriate payment to care staff. A lot of care staff are not on the living wage. And although it's not a specific issue in the bill, I think that's something that needs to be addressed. I will round up, Deputy Presiding Officer. Support the general principles of the bill. I think there are some issues here that are the policy intent is right, but I think there's some practical issues that need to be considered in stages 2 and 3 of the bill.
Many thanks. I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let me just nail my colours unambiguously to the mast, as I have in previous debates on tobacco. In the 20th century, more people were killed by smoking tobacco than died in all the wars of that century. This is a vile trade that should not exist in the 21st century. But those who have, to quote James VI, 400 years ago, been by custom in peace and peace allured to depend upon nicotine, upon tobacco, for daily relief from the stresses of life, are not the people whom we should be attacking in this debate, and I don't seek to do so. They are the victims. They are not the cause of our problem. Now, the bill that's before us addresses the issue of advertising and promotion of nicotine vapour productions, and while I welcome restrictions on a product which is certainly known to not be carrying many of the chemicals which are present in cigarettes and cause ill health and death, it is nonetheless not capable of yet being shown to be entirely safe to be sold. The US Surgeon General's report of 1989 identified 400 separate chemicals in cigarettes, at least 40 of which were carcinogens, many of which were mutagens, many were developmental toxicants. And at this stage, it simply isn't clear whether we have the level of knowledge about vapour products and the chemicals within them, either individually or in combination, and perhaps more critically, when subjected to heat, as to whether we do not have similar problems. And indeed, James Kelly quoted ASH. There's another quote from ASH in the committee's report that identifies that butterscotch with diacetyl and cinnamon, when they're heated to high temperatures, can be another factor in creating harm. And when you take what might be innocuous chemicals and heat them, you can end up with something that can be quite toxic. But if NVPs reduce harm, enable people to move away from the very well-known, well-understood problems associated with nicotine addiction, then fair enough for the time being. I'm prepared to accept them. I want to talk a fair bit about the duty of candour provisions, and in particular, I'm going to get all techie about this, the way in which the bill is actually drafted, because I think there's considerable confusion in the drafting about who persons are. The very first words in the duty of candour are, a responsible person must follow a duty of candour. And yet when you go and find what the definition of a responsible person is, the one thing you discover it isn't is a person. There are six different lines in the definition: a health board, a person, brackets, other than an individual who's entered in a contract, and so on. None of these people are capable of being a person. So I think it might be quite useful if a different term were used. Perhaps responsible entity might be an alternative definition. Now, I'm not just trying to pick at this for the sake of it. It's because person is used for other purposes in this section, and I've identified three other purposes. For example, if we move on to subsection 2, this section applies to a person to whom something may have happened. But then at subsection 3, it suddenly switches. Instead of saying person, it says individual, when it's clearly talking about the person they've been referring to in subsection 2. And if we go down to the duty of candour procedure itself, at section 22, actions to be taken by the responsible person, we then get a relevant person. But this relevant person appears to be a real person who's an individual, not a responsible person who isn't an individual. And in 22.2c, we've got the responsible person has to offer and arrange a meeting with the relevant person, which is highly confusing. And it gets even more confusing if we move on down to the definitions in 2g, where a responsible person has to make available or provide information support to persons, plural, affected by the incident, and yet it's not entirely clear who these persons, plural, might be. Are they individuals or responsible persons? And then, even more confusing, one of the duties, training to be undertaken by a responsible person. But a responsible person is specifically not defined not to be an individual. So how can an entity that's not an individual undertake training? I'm really not at all certain about that. Now, that's a little rant about that subject, but let me move on, perhaps more significantly, to reporting and monitoring, and in particular, where there have been failures. A report has to be produced, and the second part, 3B, under 24, it cannot contain any information which is, in the responsible person's opinion, is likely to identify any individual. Now, I am genuinely uncertain how that can sensibly be done, because we're looking probably at comparatively small numbers of incidents, and in particular, small numbers of incidents of a particular kind that maybe have to be described in the report. And I'm very uncertain that it will actually be possible to produce a report which has to be published, which will not lead it to be possible for that person to be identified. In our statistical analysis across government, we in general terms don't report below levels where there are five people involved to avoid that particular duty. Now, responsible person, oh, by the way, responsible person, even though the offences can cover an individual, are not included elsewhere. Now, presiding officer, just in conclusion, I just want to go back to a quote I used in 2004 when the then First Minister brought forward a statement on tobacco. Quite the best thing that he and his administration ever did, unambiguously, and I continue to praise them to the hope for that. James VI said, of tobacco, a custom loathsome to the eye, hateful to the nose, harmful to the brain, dangerous to the lungs, and in the black, stinking fume thereof, nearest resembling the horrible, stinking smoke of the pit that is bottomless. We've known tobacco is an evil, poisonous material for 400 years. Why are we still debating the subject now?
Thank you very much. And our final open debate speaker is Richard Lyle.
Listen, thank you very much. To begin, since we're all being honest, I am a smoker. I started when I was 12, and I still smoke. That is my choice. I support this bill and comment on the bill as follows. The use of nicotine vapour products, NVPs, has grown significantly over the last decade. The health benefits and the health harms of NVPs are the subject of much debate, but research evidence for either is currently limited. This presents an overwhelming social and moral case for continuing research and debate on the subject. It is important, Presiding Officer, to look at both sides of the debate. While some argue that NVPs are an effective tool for quitting or cutting down, as already has been said by my colleagues, on smoking, others have concerns that they may be a gateway to smoking, particularly among young people. This has led to calls for greater regulation of NVPs. Let me be clear, I support the use of NVPs, but also want to know what's in them. The Health, Tobacco, Nicotine and Care Scotland Bill takes this uncertainty and adopts a somewhat precautionary approach to NVPs. The bill proposes a number of restrictions on the sale, advertising and promotion of NVPs, which include a minimum purchase age of 18, the power to promote their sale from prohibit their sale from vending machines, making it an offence to purchase an NVP on behalf of someone under 18, proxy purchasing, a requirement for NVP retailers to register on the tobacco and nicotine vapour product retailer register, a requirement that registered retailers should operate an age verification policy, and the power to restrict or prohibit domestic advertising and promotions. 61% of respondents to the Health and Sport Committee called for evidence supporting all of the provisions relating to NVPs. Notably, there was most universal support for restricting the sale to over 18s. One of those supporters is the British Medical Association, the BMA. In their briefing for Stage 1 debate, the BMA fully supported an age restriction for the purchase of e-cigarettes and their refills, and agrees that they should not be sold to anyone under the age of 18. Which is in line with the current tobacco regulation. The BMA also supports the provision which makes proxy purchasing of nicotine vapour products an offence. Presiding Officer, one point that the BMA mentions in their briefing, which I agree with, is an appeal of NVPs to children and young people. Doctors have expressed significant concern over the proliferation, promotion and increasing availability of NVPs in the form of e-cigarettes and how they have the potential to increase the risk of children and young people using tobacco. According to the British Medical Association, it is estimated that a number of 11 to 18-year-olds in Great Britain have tried e-cigarettes, increased from 5% in 2013 to 8% in 2014, though regular use has remained low. I'd like to turn next to the provision with the most opposition, the plan to give ministers the power to restrict domestic advertising and promotion of NVPs. These responses have argued that this would be disproportionate to their harms and they would potentially undermine the public health benefit, such as a smoking cessation tool. According to BMA, analysis of the growing market for e-cigarettes has shown that marketing targets two distinctive audiences: current smokers who want to use NVPs as a cessation tool, and children and young people and non-smokers. We must distinguish the two audiences. On the one hand, we favour current smokers who want to use NVPs as a way to try and quit smoking, but on the other hand, we cannot allow young people to be persuaded to use NVPs, especially if they are non-smokers. A review by the United States Senate in 2014 concluded that e-cigarette companies are employing the same marketing tactics that the tobacco industry first pioneered to attract young consumers to their products. I'd now like to move on to part two of the bill, the duty of candour. At the moment, NHS boards are required to implement learning from adverse events through reporting and review. This framework sets out a national approach to identifying, reporting and reviewing adverse events and is drawn from best practice. Following a number of reviews in England, there have been calls for greater candour amongst health and care organisations when things go wrong. As a consequence, this bill proposes to give health, social care and social work organisations a duty of candour. What this would mean is that in the event of a person experienced or could have experienced an unintended or unexpected harm from their care, the organisation would have a duty to tell that individual. The bill proposes to give a duty of candour to responsible persons. I think Mr Stevenson explained the situation in regard to that, who are defined as NHS boards, anyone other than an individual contracted by NHS board to provide a health service, GP practice, community pharmacy. Anyone other than an individual providing independent healthcare services, a local authority, and anyone other than an individual who provides a care service or social work service. In the event that a person in receipt of health, social care or social work services experiences an unintended or unexpected incident, which in the opinion of the registered health professional results or could have resulted in a death or harm. Those in support of this measure, around 58.5% of the respondents to the committee's call for evidence, felt a duty of candour would engender a culture of openness and learning. Whilst critics argued that legislation was not the appropriate approach to create an open culture, and defined harms were very broad and could have encompassed very minor events, therefore resulting in a significant drain on resources. Organisations such as the Royal College of Nursing support the creation of a legal requirement for health. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by again highlighting some of the key features of this bill. The Health Bill aims to control the sale, advertising and promotion of nicotine vapour products such as e-cigarettes by a minimum purchasing age of 18, having the power to prohibit their sale from vending machines and make it an offence to purchase NVP on behalf of someone under 18. We cannot allow young people to be influenced to start using NVPs. We can hope to educate them so that when they mature, they can make the right decision. Can I end by saying, this bill also makes an offence to smoke within a designated zone outside an NHS hospital site or an entrance. I welcome that. I also want to make the plea that boards do allow people in certain areas in their hospitals, as we need to steadily educate people who do smoke in order to eradicate this bad practice outside hospital doors. Thank you.
Many thanks. That brings us to the closing speeches. And to call on Jackson Carlow, maximum 7 minutes, please, Mr Carlow.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At 2 o'clock this afternoon, in his thought for reflection, Father Jeremy Bath hoped that our afternoon would neither drag nor fly by. Well, I can assure him it hasn't done the latter. As to the former, I'll leave others to decide. I'd like to congratulate the Minister, and in particular, actually, Duncan McNeill, I think, for detailing to the Chamber really quite a comprehensive and interesting committee report on this legislation. And I have to say, of measures brought before us, I'm overwhelmed by a lack of enthusiasm at the moment for
the legislation we're considering. And I actually wonder if it all went away, whether the public good would be adversely affected. And I'm unpersuaded at the moment, although on balance, we are going to support the bill tonight. And I hope that as it goes through its various stages, some of the concerns that have been raised will be addressed. I actually have a lot of sympathy with part three of the bill. I think there are specific examples that we can think of where the willful neglect has not been effectively dealt with. And I think that the government's proposals in that regard are to be welcomed, although there are questions surrounding them. And I thought Jenny Marra and others spoke to the issues relating to the duty of candour with some conviction and credibility. And I think there's a lot more that needs to be teased out in the detail of that. But I am going to speak principally on the e-cigarette element of this. Now, when I say I'm unpersuaded, some members may realise that there is something of a division between Nanette Milne and myself at this stage as we consider the debate, not quite of Corbynista proportions. We are on the same path, but not yet at the same destination. There will be no need for a free vote. We'll come to a unified position in due course. But I thought kind of it started off for me with Duncan McNeill, who was going through the various devices that there are. And my recollection when we first debated this was that my primary concern initially was the health risks associated with the delivery devices of e-cigarettes, where we knew that they had exploded in people's hands and where some people were ingesting formaldehyde and various other things. And I know that the responsibility for that lies elsewhere. And I hope that all the work that needs to be done is being done there, because some of the reports we heard from the manufacturer of these devices in some very kind of unregulated markets finding their way into the United Kingdom and to the people who are utilising them was of huge concern. But as Duncan McNeill talked about, I still find the sight of people using these vapour devices strange. For me, I don't know how many of a certain vintage may remember Christopher Lee's Fu Manchu in the 1960s, used to use what looked like one of these devices to me. And I've always kind of associated it as a slightly strange, kind of cultish looking practice. But nonetheless, it has become more prevalent. And what concerns me about the mood of this debate is that we overstate the concerns. And I think I come to where Malcolm Chisholm and Kevin, God, I forgot his Stuart, gosh, sorry, were on this. I support the issue in relation to vending machines, to under 18s and to the register. But I'm a bit worried that the term, the lack of evidence, was at times being used in this debate as an assumption that there will be evidence yet to be discovered and forthcoming, which is such that we should be putting a wall up in front of these products now. And my concern when I heard Stuart Maxwell is, you know, there are all sorts of habits that are more deadly and dangerous to public health on which we're not legislating than this one which we are. And that's not a reason not to be precautious. But, well, I will shortly. But what I concerned, and I heard him talk about the manufacturers of these devices, the sellers being the tobacco firms. I heard Christina McKelvey say exactly. Now, I've always felt Christina McKelvey can see a conspiracy in a vase of flowers. But here is an inconvenient truth. The people who are buying up the companies who manufacture these devices are indeed the tobacco companies. And there is a conundrum. Because if, in fact, e-cigarettes potentially can save the lives of tens of thousands of people, there are people dropping dead of traditional tobacco smoke in their hundreds of thousands today. There are not people dropping dead of e-cigarettes. If, in fact, it is proven in due course that the harmful effects Mr. Maxwell thinks we should be taking precautions against do not transpire, then I don't want us to create an atmosphere and a hysteria and a tone around e-cigarettes which is potentially prejudicial to what in those circumstances should be our objective, to promote them aggressively to those who currently smoke to get them off traditional tobacco and perhaps contribute to save their lives. And the uncomfortable truth about that would be that that would be to the benefit of the profits
of the tobacco companies who own the devices. And yes, I'm uncomfortable about that, but I'd rather they made their money out of e-cigarettes than that they made their money out of traditional tobacco, which is undoubtedly killing without argument. Mr. Maxwell.
Stuart Maxwell. Well,
surprisingly, though, it may seem to the member, I actually agree with him. Because the point here, and the point I was trying to make, and maybe I didn't make it well enough, is that I have no problem in supporting the use of e-cigarettes as a cessation product for those who are currently on tobacco. I think that is a good thing. My concern is about the long-term consequences of the use of them, some of them mentioned, and also promoting it to young people as a fashionable habit.
Jason Carlaw, you're in your last minute.
And in that sense, I can say that we are agreed. I'm just worried that we don't over-egg the mood music around which we discuss these to create a prejudice which actually makes people equate these products at the present time with traditional tobacco. May I say just in the final few seconds to that efficacious and delightful member of the SNP, Mr. Gibson, who has a ballot paper in his possession in the list ranking election, that the rules I drew up forbid any member from soliciting votes, so of course I can't do that. I would say to Mr. Gibson, who like me is of a certain age, falling into corpulent middle age as we both are, there is still a place for people of our age in this Parliament. But of course, for him to complete that ballot, he would have to sign a pledge of allegiance to truth, justice and the Conservative way, an obstacle I think that may be insurmountable to Mr. Gibson. The Conservatives will be supporting the bill at its first reading tonight.
Many thanks. I now call on Rhoda Grant. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the bill and I'm supportive of the direction of travel within the bill. But can I just echo some of the comments made by Nanette Milne when she spoke about the Minister's response to the committee not coming until late yesterday afternoon. And I know there have been occasions where the government response to the committee report has not come before the debate, but we're pushing through a lot of legislation through the Parliament, especially through the Health and Sport Committee. And it's important that that legislation is well scrutinised. So it's important that we get responses from the government that give committee members time to consider that. And even the Minister's announcement today that part three of the bill won't extend to children, but we'll be given the reasons for that in a couple of days' time. I think we need all that information, because pushing through legislation, we have to make sure the legislation is good, that it's fit for purpose, otherwise we all fail. So even when we're supportive of the legislation, it's important that the government give us the information they require. Can I possibly turn the bill on its head as I address the comments made and to first turn to ill treatment and willful neglect? And can I echo Jenny Mara's comments about health and care workers who do a tremendous job in very difficult situations? And I think while we talk about those issues, we have to remember that we hear of an unfortunate but small number of cases where patients have suffered ill treatment and willful neglect, and we need to deal with those, leaving no chance of recurrence, and make sure that the people that do that are treated appropriately under the law. There is a concern in the bill that the bill deals with a duty of candour and deals with ill treatment and willful neglect, and I think other speakers have made the point, but I'll reiterate the point that those two things are not connected in any way. A duty of candour is to do with mistakes where no harm was intended. The ill treatment and willful neglect clause in the bill is where people have willfully neglected a patient, have taken steps, almost premeditated steps, to make sure that they are not looked after. All too often we pick up the newspapers and read stories where care homes have been abysmal. Often in these cases it's because of a lack of trained staff, and the owner of the establishment needs to be prosecuted rather than the staff. If staff are found to be guilty of ill treatment and willful neglect because they haven't been trained properly, they've been understaffed and haven't received support, that should not be the case. That should go back to the person that is managing that training rather than the staff themselves. And too often...
Minister?
Can I assure the member that that part of the bill on ill treatment and willful neglect, which are well known in legal circles, is not about people not being able to do their job because of different circumstances. It's where a person intentionally sets out to harm or ill-treat somebody.
Rosie Grant.
And the point I was making was if that intention is by a care home owner, for example, who underfunds and understaffs a care home, leaving a member of staff unable to give adequate care to a patient, that must be the care owner that is held to account rather than the member of staff who has been trying maybe under the best of their ability to cope in a bad situation. Too often we find serial offenders here, people who own multiple care home licences. When they're found to be wanting at one, we need to make sure that all their licences are revoked as part of that, and that could be an amendment at stage two or three. That said, there is wonderful practice that we need to make sure is continued through all our care home sector and that patients are looked after. Can I turn to the duty of candour, which again I say is very, very different from the willful neglect clause of the bill. And a point I would make is that it's very complex, and I think Stuart Stevenson talked at length about the procedure for how this happens, and I think it's important that we have some clarity as to how that would happen. For example, organisations and the like, where a GP, for example, is working on their own, who provides the independent input? And if somebody other than the person who has been seen to have made the mistake apologises, does that break down the relationship between that clinician and their patient? Would it not be better for the person, if appropriate, who's made the mistake to make that apology? But I would also make the plea that candour is important and should actually run through all the interactions that health and care professionals have with patients and clients, because I think patients need to be very clear that if something happens to them, regardless of a serious impact or not, that they are told. Now, I take on board what Malcolm Chisholm said about a patient's right not to know. That is up to the patient. But I think the fallback position should always be that a patient knows if something has gone wrong, regardless of whether they have suffered ill effect or not, that they are aware of what has happened with them. Can I turn to smoking in hospital grounds and another issue that has had a lot of debate today, and still we're still looking for some clarity about this. The Scottish Government suggests it could be between 10 and 15 metres of buildings, but I think we need to be much more clearer about that. Would that be if the boundaries, what would happen if the boundaries to the hospital grounds were less than 10 or 15 metres, what would be, would they be covered by the ban as well? Also, I want to bring to the government's attention the part of the bill that talks about permitting people to smoke in hospital grounds. I would be pleased if the minister would put on record that a member of staff who takes a patient out, if they feel that is in the best interests in their patient and important to that patient's well-being, that if they take them outside to smoke, that they are not in breach of this and won't be disciplined for it, because a clinician or a nurse is first duty is to their patient's well-being, and this legislation shouldn't overturn that. There might be only a very small number of incidences where that would happen and be at the well-being of the patient, but we need to make sure that that is very, very clear. Can I turn to NVPs very quickly, as I'm running out of time, Presiding Officer? I think what was clear in the debate today that they are 95% safer than smoking, and smokers are 60% more likely to quit when using NVPs. And those statistics can't be ignored. I know there is huge concern about us attracting a new brand of nicotine addicts, but if this actually gets people off the more harmful effects of smoking, then I think we really have to see how we can encourage smokers to take up NVPs as an alternative, but also take steps to make sure that young people and non-smokers aren't encouraged to take them up. With that, I would close, but again reiterate our support for the bill and hope that it can be clarified and strengthened at stage two and three.
Many thanks. I now call on Maureen Watt to wind up the debate, please. Minister, you have until 5 p.m.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank all members for a very good and constructive debate on this very important piece of legislation. There are some issues, obviously, that may need further consideration, but it's great to hear that there is support for the principles of the bill. Unlike Jason Carlow, who's underwhelmed by the bill, it is an important milestone. Measures to control tobacco, NVP products and smoking will play their part alongside the vast range of measures that will continue to be progressed by the Scottish Government to promote public health in Scotland. Part 1 also furthers the aims of the Scottish Government's tobacco control strategy to support longer, healthier lives and to tackle the significant inequalities in Scottish society. And I recognise that there is an ongoing debate about the emerging evidence on the use of NVPs, and that has been highlighted in the debate. It is a relatively new product, and research is emerging all the time about the benefits or otherwise of it, and who is using it and who is not. There's obviously a role for NVP products, but at the moment we don't know the extent of that role. There's a research emerging all the time, and long-term research is obviously required, but we do know that NVPs are used along with other cessation services that are playing a key role in this field. And the Scottish Government is working with NHS Scotland and NHS boards to develop a consistent approach on this. NHS Health Scotland last year issued a position statement on NVPs, and it is renewing it to take account of the latest evidence. And Hans Alan Malik highlighted the difference of opinion among members. On the one hand, we have Kenny Gibson and Stuart Maxwell, Jim Hume and John Mason urging caution.
Excuse me, Minister. Could members come into the chamber, please? Do it quietly. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. And urging caution and not wanting to create a new generation of smokers through NVPs. And on the other hand, we had Kevin Stewart, an advocate of NVPs, which has helped him to stop smoking, and Malcolm Chisholm supporting that. But we absolutely do not want to demonise people who use e-cigarettes, and there's nothing in this bill that suggests that is the case. The bill is an attempt to balance, to protect young people from taking up smoking and normalising the habit of smoking, but also allowing smokers to switch to e-cigarettes. And I think that's the balance that James Kelly also highlighted. And it's a balanced approach which is welcomed by stakeholders, including ASH Scotland. So we need to reduce the visibility and the appeal to young people and smokers while not reducing the potential of the benefits to current cigarette smokers. And I welcome the Health and Sport Committee's support for such an approach, and know that many witnesses, as I said, have also expressed their support for the proposals. If we move to putting smoking outside hospitals on a statutory footing, it is an important step forward in tobacco control in Scotland. This government has been clear that we will consider all necessary action to see a tobacco-free generation in Scotland by 2034. And continuing to denormalise smoking in society will help us achieve this ambitious aim. There have been diverging views as to how smoke-free hospital grounds should be achieved. However, most agree that sending a clear and consistent message that NHS Scotland is a health-promoting health service and that smoking on hospital grounds is not socially acceptable. And there's strong public support for this. And health boards have had policies around smoke-free grounds since 2006. but they have asked us for a consistency of approach, and that is not without its challenges. But John Mason asked about enforcement, and can I say that local authorities already get £2.5 million to support existing smoke-free legislation. We have asked COSLA to provide us with information if they think that this will put extra pressures on them and how much extra money they would require. And so far, we have not had any reply to this. So again, in this, presiding officer, it's about striking a balance in achieving our public health policy on smoking in a fair approach to patients and visitors. And I take Rhoda Grant's point about the sensitivity for patients, but the legislation is in relation to persistent offenders, and we're not talking about health workers in this regard in relation to mental health patients. Obviously, health boards recognise this particular point, and I think we know now that smoking is not a reliever of stress. In fact, it can contribute to stress, and this is where making sure that every single patient is given the opportunity for smoking cessation services is really important. If we move on to the duty of candour, being candid promotes an accountability for safer systems, better engages staff in improvement efforts, and engenders greater trust in patients and user services. And can I thank Jenny Mara for raising the point about disciplinary hearings? But this bill doesn't relate to professional regulations or the provision of legal aid for such hearings. The focus is on the organisational duty of candour, and with respect to criminal, to willful neglect and criminal offences. I will ask my officials to review the concerns and provide a response to outline the government's position. We are working with professional organisations to ensure that provisions within the bill, including staff training and support, take account of staff experience and expertise, but they're focused on enhancing working conditions where there have been unintended or unexpected.
One moment, Minister. There's just far too much chattering around the chamber. Could you please respect the Minister by listening to her? Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So we have been working with stakeholders to ensure that what is happening is that we focus on enhancing working conditions where there have been unintended consequences or unexpected incidents relating to harm.
Jenny Mara. Jenny Mara, can we have a microphone on? Can we have your card in, Ms. Mara?
Apologies, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for giving way. I wonder if she'll be so kind as to look at the issue I raised at stage two of this bill about many care workers being unrepresented legally and have no access to legal aid at the SSSC disciplinary hearings, and will perhaps provide a response with numbers of those and arrangements for those to me.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I said, this is not in relation... I will look at what she says, but this has got nothing to do with this bill. As I said, it's an organisational duty of candour, not in relation to individuals. The legislative requirement is to publish reports outlining the learning and change through the application of the duty of candour procedure, and this will positively contribute to transparent, open and engaged public services that are committed to continuous improvement. In relation to using the negative procedure for regulation, the procedures will set out measures in great detail, and this is not unusual not to have it on the face of the bill, but as members know, it is done in detailed consultation and scrutiny of the stakeholders. In relation to Part 3, Presiding Officer, the ill treatment and willful neglect offences in the bill will allow the police and courts to address those cases of deliberate neglect and ill treatment which can happen in health and social care settings. These instances are rare, but are nevertheless a breach of trust, and it is right that such behaviours are dealt with appropriately. Again, we will be working with partner organisations and stakeholders to publicise the offences among health and social care workers and providers, as well as those who receive it. I want to reiterate that it's not intended to apply to mistakes, but it is to willful or intentional acts. And if we look at existing legislation in relation to mental health, there's no evidence that anybody is being unnecessarily criminalised. And the Association for Victims of Medical Accidents, representing people directly affected by harm, do support this aspect of the bill.
Can you close, name?
Yes, Presiding Officer. I close and ask the Parliament to support this bill.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on stage one of the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. At the next item of business is consideration of motion number 14200 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. And I call on John Swinney to move the motion. Deputy First Minister.
Move, President Officer.
Thank you. The question on this motion will come at decision time, to which we now come. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 15003, in the name of Maureen Watt, on the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14200, in the name of John Swinney, on the financial resolution for the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.